Good evening, everyone. Last week, we started to speak about the Parashat Yitro, and I told you that we only did half of it because the second part is the Ten Commandments, is receiving the Torah. My plan was to do the lecture the next day, the second part, but then we had the big snowstorm. So I will have to finish it now, and tomorrow, Bezrat Hashem, I'll do Parashat Mishpatim. The last thing we said in the Shiur last week was that Yitro came and gave Moshe an advice that he has to set up a court system, and nominate judges, and the judges, you know, they should obviously take different territories and judge the cases, because one person cannot judge the entire nation. The advice that Yitro gave Moshe was that the big cases you should judge, and the small cases, the other judges, the beginners, the younger judges, they should judge. Later, Moshe took his advice with one major change, which really tells the difference between Judaism to other court system, the laws of the Torah, supposed to secular laws all over the world, even in Israel, in a secular court, that when you have a judge that is a beginner, they won't give him cases that is millions of dollars, that is large cases. They will only give him small cases. Why? You know, he's only a beginner. It doesn't matter how difficult the case is to judge. The case can be very complicated. It can be only $1,000 case, but it can be very complicated, which means there's so many contradictions and witnesses and problems and missing evidence. So a beginner judge obviously would not know how to control the case. But they won't give it to him. Why? Because it's only $1,000. Who's going to give a judge that is 20, 30 years in court, who's going to give him a case of $1,000? We go by how big is the case. Moshe did not do the advice of Yitro 100%. The change that Moshe made, the Torah say later that the difficult cases Moshe took for himself, and the easy cases he gave to the easier cases, there's really no easy case 100%, but the easier cases he gave it to the other judge, which means he didn't go by the dollar amount, by how much is the case is. He go by how difficult the case is to judge. Why? Because we have a rule in the Torah, din pruta ki din me'ah. The judgment of one penny, it could be equal like a hundred. Why? Because we don't go by the dollar amount. We go by the justice. What's the justice? Whether you stole a dollar, whether you stole 10, 50, 100, or a million, to the actual stealing, it's a violation. Yes, of course. I mean, the bigger the amount of the delegation is, it makes the case more interesting. And I mean, obviously, you have more incentive to judge fairly. But overall, this is one very solid difference between the laws of the Torah and the laws of all the secular courts. Even here in America, they have a small claim court, which is like 6 in the evening. It's 10-20 minutes each case. You come in front of a judge that is already retired or something like that, that is not an active judge. And it's up to $3,000, if I remember correctly, you know, 15, 20 years ago, that was the case. But it's small cases, and it's 1, 2, 3. You bring your evidence, he brings his evidence, one after the other. Maybe it's a complicated case, maybe you need to call witnesses. There's no time. It's a 5 minutes case, it's a 10 minutes case, since it's small dollar amount. But in a bed din, if Reuven sue Shimon for $1,000, it's such a big amount. Nobody will die from such an amount. It doesn't matter. It may take a long, long time until they reach a verdict. Why? It doesn't matter. We have to know, because if we're going to rule the opposite of the truth, even for $1,000 or even for $100, a person will have a serious problem in Shamayim. Comes in front of Hashem. And Hashem say, listen, you left the world with money that it's not yours. And as I told you before, a person cannot enter heaven if he has stolen money in his hands. It's a serious problem. Now, some sins that we do, Hashem can judge a person And he can take his soul and judge it and clean the soul, and eventually the person doesn't have to come back here in reincarnation. However, when it's involved with stealing, the person must come back to this world. Must come back to this world. And he has to come back to this world. And the only way that he can pay back the money is to pay back to the person he stole from. It's not like today, if somebody stole a lot of money, they put him in jail. The people who he stole the money from, what do they get from it? Okay, so he's in jail. The punishment shouldn't be about revenge. The punishment should be that a person has to pay back. As we saw in Parashat Mishpatim, a person who stole, pay double. Why? Pay what you took from a person, and now we're giving you the same feeling of what you did to him. It's an educational punishment, hoping that you will never repeat the crime after you feel how it feels. All right, so now the question that we still have to ask, why Moshe thought that he can judge an entire nation with so many people by himself? The answer is, we have a rule. Vayeshev Moshe lishpot et ha'am. Every time it say am, without Am Israel or without Bnei Israel, usually it refers to the Erev Rav. Erev Rav means Egyptians. Erev Rav, the Egyptians that Moshe Rabbeinu converted based in his own opinions. We know he took many of them out of Mitzrayim and they caused some problems. One of the problems they caused was the golden calf. It was in their nature to worship an idol. And they worship the sheep and the cows and all these animals and the Niles. So they have a history of idol worshiping. So they made a lot of problems. This nation came right away. If somebody can open the door there. This nation, for the ladies section over there. Thank you. So what happened is when the Egyptians came, the Erev Rav, they came to Moshe and they say to him, listen, you came out of Egypt and you robbed us. You borrow gold and silver and all kinds of things. We want to sue for our money. When was that? It was a day after Yom Kippur. If you know, Moshe went up to the mountain for 40 days. In Zayin Besivan, and he was there for 40 days, and he came back and used Zayin Betamuz, 17 of Tammuz, and he saw the golden calf, whatever they made over there, and he broke the commandments. And he went back the next day on Yutchet Betamuz, the next day, the 18th of Tammuz, and he stayed in the mountain for 80 days. And the last period, which was the last 40 days, between Rosh Chodesh Elul, the beginning of Elul, until the 10th day of Tishrei, which is Yom Kippur, that's when Hashem told Moshe, I forgive you as you cried and begged for the sin of the golden calf. So I'm forgiving you today. And this day will be memorized as a day, as an annual day for forgiveness. Every day will be Yom Kippur, Yom Slicha u'Chapara, a day of repentance. So when Moshe came, the Torah said the next day he set to judge the nation. What nation? The nation of Israel had no cases. What cases they have? They receive money for free. They receive bread falling. They came out of Egypt. What money you need in a desert? They took from Egypt plenty of gold and silver. Everyone has donkeys full of jewelry. There's the divine supervision. They saw miracles in Egypt. Who would go and steal? What for? You have as much as you. What are you going to do with this jewelry in the desert? You have plenty of gold, silver, diamonds, all kinds of things. So what's the point? After the Egyptian drowns in the water, the Chazal say the Bizat Hayam was even greater than Bizat Mitzrayim. What they got from the horses and the carriages, so much wealth they got, was even more than what they took out of from the Egyptians as they borrow with no intention to pay back. So now they loaded. Each one of them is very, very rich. There's nothing you can do with the money. If you're on the moon, stuck on the moon, you went to the moon with a spaceship and you have lots of diamonds, and the spaceship left without you. What's the diamonds going to do any good for you? So why will I steal from you? What possible lawsuits the Jews should have had one from another? Nothing. Here comes the Oral Torah in teaching us the secret. What does it mean? No, the Egyptians came and they said to Moshe, wait, thank you very much. We're happy you finally showed up. You were late for a few hours. We have a case here. Listen, you two, you came out of Mitzrayim. You stole from us. So Moshe said to them, I don't understand. You're not Egyptians anymore. You're Jews now. I converted you. You joined the Jewish nation. So what did they say? Fine, just because we used to be non-Jews and you stole from us, doesn't mean we give it up. What, if I used to be a goy and you stole from me and I became a Jew, I leave you alone? Oh, because I'm a new person. Yes, the soul merged into me. Fine. Well, what do you expect us to give up all this money? So the question is, okay, they come to Moshe. Okay, it's like every other court case. So Moshe should put a court to judge them. So Yitro gave him an advice, take many judges, you cannot judge them on your own. Moshe say, it's a problem, I cannot really put judges. I can't really put judges, why? Because all the judges are people who took the jewelry from them. How a judge can judge himself? They all took money. I'm the only one who never stole a penny from them. Chas v'shalom, the word stole is not the right word, because the Torah say to borrow. Borrow, but if a person borrow with no intention to pay back, usually it's, the Torah call him lo vera shave lo yishalem. It's wicked. But over here, it was a mitzvah. Why Hashem say to do it? Why Hashem say to do it? You work here for 83 years, from 210 years they were there after Yosef passed away until the slavery started. 83 years, about 16 hours a day, millions of people. That's a huge amount of salary you have to make. They owe them billions. They're obviously not going to pay. So Hashem say, borrow. Don't tell them, you must give us. Because you have to understand, the Egyptians were all the way depressed and broken. Why? Why the depressed and broken? Because they saw the 10 plagues. They saw what happened in Egypt. Everything in their life got destroyed. Their God got destroyed. The Jews slaughtered their sheep, which was their gods. The Nile became blood. The entire ideology were smashed to pieces. Plus, every firstborn died. In every house, everyone mourned. Everyone is upset, depressed. So now when someone comes and says, please lend me some clothes and some jewelry and all kinds of things. So what do you expect from them? If you come and tell them, pay us, you owe us, they won't give. But to lend, they gave. Why Hashem called it to borrow? Because he knew when someone borrow and he ran away, the person that owns the money runs after him. You understand? If it was a payment, if you paid someone and he ran away, well, what's the problem? It's his money. But if you lend him the money and he ran away, right away you get nervous. You run to the airport to stop him, right? Anywhere he goes. You understand? So what's the point here? So Hashem wanted them to chase them, that he should show them the miracles he's going to do in the Red Sea. And that's exactly what happened. They chased them with 600 carriages, and they drowned. The army drowned. The army drowned. Very good, beautiful. So the only one who did not steal from them or took anything with no intention to return was who? Was Moshe. He went to chase, to look for the ark, the cave, the body of Yosef. Yosef was his body, the Egyptians put his body in the Niles because they knew he was a holy man. And he brought all the wealth to Egypt. Thanks to him, Egypt got saved financially. That's before the plagues, of course. So they put the body of Yosef inside the Niles. Why? The Niles is their god. He comes up and he gives water to all the little lakes, to all the water. So the Niles, this is what they worship. So if the body of Yosef is inside the Nile, first of all, the Jews will never be able to take him out as he requested, because Yosef made him swear, when you leave this country, you must take my body out with you. You don't leave Egypt without me. So what did the Egyptians do? They threw his body inside the Niles. And in the end, Moshe went to search for it. Everyone was busy robbing the Egyptians for all the years we worked for them for free. At least we can get something out of them, compensation. And Moshe was busy searching for the body of Yosef. So Moshe was the only one can judge them. That's why the Torah say Moshe sat alone to judge them. Yitro did not understand all the calculation. He see one person trying to judge thousands of people. They all standing online. So he say to him, Nabol Tipol, you want to destroy yourself? So this is the secret of this conversation between Moshe and his father-in-law Yitro. Now I have to remember, Yitro is the previous Pope. He's the Pope of the generation. The difference between the Pope of today to Yitro in that time is only one. The Pope today is specialized in one religion, Christianity. That's his religion. You ask the Pope about Islam, most likely he doesn't know anything about it or any other cult or religion. He will tell you, I represent Christianity. Yitro wasn't like that. Yitro was a master of all idol worshippers. He knew all the cults. He was like teaching people how to specialize in all kinds of idol worshippings. Now you ask me, how does a person worship few different idols? If you worship one idol, why would you go to a competitor? This is your God. You worship this God, like the Buddhist. They bow down to their Buddha. If you bring them, a statue out of nowhere, you bring them a statue of the Rambam, they won't worship it. They will only worship their symbol, which is Buddha. Buddha started Buddhism 2,400 years ago. So how does Yitro go from one idol worshiping to another? There's two answers to it. One, he was searching for the truth himself, trying here, trying there, trying another one. He was also moving from one to another, like some people in this world. They try one cult after the other until they finally reach a religion that they follow for the rest of their life. Second reason is, there's not always a contradiction. The idols are all fake. They're not really God. The idols have a power. The answer is absolutely not. They don't have a power on their own. However, as a part of the test, HaKadosh Baruch Hu give the idols sometimes. It looks like that they help. Person is he has a sick kid, and they take the kid to some idol, and they do all kinds of avodah zarah, the Indian, the Chinese. You know, people think the idol worshiping is not anymore in the world like it used to be, but it's a big mistake. You have hundreds of millions of people in the world worshiping idols daily. You go to some places in Tibet, in all kinds of places in the Far East, China, Thailand, India, and many other countries, almost every person there is an idol worshiper. Almost every person. We're talking hundreds of millions of people. They have big statues, some of them size of a building. They go, thousands of them go, they make all kinds of festivals, they go around the statues. You see the picture, you won't believe that people in our days do this. Now, what's the difference today to 3,000 or 4,000 years ago? Today, really between you and I, if you look at these idols, they're not performing nothing. Nothing. They're not just a piece of rock or a piece of wood or a piece of gold. That's it. And the Gentiles are following it, many of them, and they believe in it and they pray to it, even though these idols do not perform anything. Can worship the table, can worship the wall. It's really the same. There's no difference. In the old days, there was a very, very strong desire for these idols. As the Gemara says, Rav Ashi used to teach in Yeshiva, and he was teaching about all kinds of famous people who lost their share to the world to come. One day he arrived he said, tomorrow we will speak about our friend Menashe. Menashe was the son of King Chizkiyahu. And King Chizkiyahu was a very righteous king that in his days the Jewish nation reached the highest level ever. But his son Menashe was the total opposite of his father. It happens sometimes the father is a tzaddik and the son is not exactly, you know. So what happened? This Menashe is bringing idols and making all kinds of things. Lots of problems in his days. So Rav Ashi say, tomorrow we're going to learn about Menashe, which one of these wicked kids. At night, when he went to sleep, he came to him in a dream. This king Menashe came to him in a dream, to Rav Ashi. Now Rav Ashi and Ravina are the two rabbis who wrote the Talmud. They concluded the Talmud. if you ever read the Talmud, or even if you learn one page in a Talmud, then you become speechless. There's no words really to even try to describe their brilliance, their memory, their control, their knowledge. It's superpower. It's not human. Why? There's thousands of pages in a Talmud. Every two, three, or four lines can go from one subject to another. And some subjects repeats in the Talmud many, many times in different pages. Now remember, it took them many, many years to write it, not a year or two. Many, many years, most likely most of their life. They were sitting to conclude, because it's 400 years of Jewish oral laws. All the oral laws from the time of the Mishnah of Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi until they wrote the Talmud, about 400 years. 400 years of all the laws, of all the yeshivot, of all the rabbis, of all the subjects, all over the world, mainly in Babylon. So now what's going on? They concluded every topic with no contradiction. What Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai say here, what he say in another Mishnah, what this rabbi say, this one, and this, and that. Everything, they edit everything together. There's no computers like today. You do search and the computer bring you all the subjects on the screen and everything is in front of you in a minute. No, it's all in the head. So Rav Ashi was one of them, Rav Ashi and Ravina. Rav Ashi was the main one. Ravina was younger than him. So Rav Ashi is speaking about someone which was a big idol worshiper and made the entire nation of Israel follow idols. And he called him our friend, meaning he puts him down. Like sometimes you say, our friend, such and such, and everybody knows, you know, the last thing he is our friend. Right? This is what he meant. This Menashe, which lived about 800 years before Rav Ashi, at least, maybe even more, a little bit, comes to him in a dream. After 800 years, he's not alive, or maybe 900 years. He comes to him and he says, who did you dare to call your friend? You're calling me your friend? You think I'm in your level? So Rav Ashi said to him in a dream, you don't want to be my friend? The last I remember, you're the one who made the entire nation of Israel worship idols, not me. I give my life for the Torah, I learn, I teach, I write, I'm not an idol worshiper. So he said to him, tell me, if you're such a big rabbi, tell me when you make a motzi on the bread, where are you cutting the bread from? So Rav Ashi said to him, I didn't know there's a special law for that, where you cut the bread from. What difference does it make? You make a motzi lechem min haaretz, you cut the bread and eat. He told him, no. You have to cut the most well-done piece. A piece that is baked the most. So Rav Ashi said to him, if you're such a brilliant chacham in halacha, you know Jewish law, to such small details that most people don't even pay attention to, how exactly you were dealing with idols? So he told him, this is what most people don't get. He told him, if you lived in my generation, you would pick up your dress. They used to wear long dresses, the rabbis, like special kilts. You would pick up your dress and run, sprint, to worship these idols. You're judging me after hundreds of years later? Do you know what strong desires the world had for these idol worshippers? For this idol worshiping? This is the story. So now you ask, why the world has a desire for idols? If you take a Jew or Israeli guy and tell him, listen, I want to take you on a fantastic tour. What's the tour? I want to take you to India. They have big temples over there with lots of idols. We're going to go around the idol. We clap, we sing, we do all kinds of things. He's going to tell you, are you normal? So no, don't worry, we'll pay the flight, we'll pay the hotel. I believe not one person would agree to join this foolish trip. Who even has desire for such thing? Usually people don't have, today it's not. But in the old days, people used to have a sick person in their family, they bring him to these idols, and all of a sudden it helps. And even Micha, which was a baby, when the Egyptian took him and wanted to kill him alive, and Moshe said to Hashem, how do you let them kill babies? And Hashem said, oh, you're questioning me? Take him out of the construction. Take him out. And this Micha grew up. And what was he doing? He had an idol and he called Jews to worship his idol. To worship his idols. So the angel used to go angry when they see what Micha is doing. Now, when is Micha doing it? As he witnessed all the miracles that Hashem did in Mitzrayim, he does not let go to his idol. Still calling people to come. People saw, people hear some miracles in Mitzrayim. They're going out of Mitzrayim right now. What does Micha has? He has his statue. He carry it with him. Lavan. Hashem spoke to Lavan. What does it do? An hour later, he comes to Yaakov. Who stole my idol? Hashem spoke to you. Worry about your idol? Idol, I have it with me all the time. I call it and miracles happen. Like kishufim, like black magic. It was a very common thing. So next time when you hear about it, at least you have an idea why people had such a strong desire for all these idols. It doesn't make sense. So Yitro was a master of idol worshiping. Not just an idol worshiper. From his position to drop everything and to come and convert to Judaism, that's not an ordinary thing. It's not just another convert. Perhaps he's the most amazing convert in history for male. And then Ruth for female. Those are the two most famous converts in history. What was his reward? There's a parasha in the Torah called Parashat Yitro. And his daughter Tzipora was given to Moshe Rabbeinu to be his wife, which means he became the father-in-law of the most important person in the world. The secret here is that according to Kabbalah, Moshe is reincarnation of Hevel. Hevel, Cain killed him. Two brothers, Cain and Hevel. Cain killed Hevel, and then they came back in reincarnation many, many years later. We are talking about 2,400 years later, the souls are not corrected yet. Unbelievable. So what happened? Yitro used to be Cain, and Moshe used to be Hevel. Cain killed Hevel because Hevel had two twins born with him. Those things you don't read in a written Torah. This is secrets. It's either Midrashim or Kabbalah. It comes from the oral Torah. And Cain had only one twin, so he was always jealous. There's few reasons why he killed him. One of the reasons are that he had two girls and he had one. And there's no problem yet because, you know, it was just the beginning of the creation. The Torah wasn't given. All the laws of relation and relationships were not given yet. So what happened? Cain killed him. Later he comes back and he gives him a girl. I kill you for a girl, I'm giving you a girl. Who? Tzipora, my daughter. To correct what I did. At the same time, a part of the soul of Cain was reincarnated in another body, which explained to us that a person can be reincarnated in more than one body. And who he was? The Egyptian that Moshe killed. The Egyptian was beating up the Jew, wants to kill him. Moshe, it said, Vayach Moshe et Amitzri. Moshe said the name of Hashem, Shema Meforash. This Egyptian fell and died. That's the reason why Moshe had to escape from Egypt. He was a prince. After that, Paro was looking to kill him. That's what Vayatzileni Micherev Paro, that Moshe said, thank you Hashem for saving me from the sword of Paro. Paro was searching all over. Moshe escaped to Midian. Yitro was Kohen Midian, the Torah says. Yitro, Kohen, Midian. So what happened? A part of Cain was in this Egyptian. You killed me in a sin. I killed you legally. Killing against killing. That sin is repented. That's it. It's finished. But it's also the reason why you killed me. For a girl. What's the repentance? You got to give me a girl. You killed me for a girl. You took me from the girl. Now you have to give me a girl. It's all measure for measure. I know it sounds very complicated. Usually what it is in this generation, there are people who never learn Torah. They don't really learn. They're busy with what they do. Even they keep mitzvot. Some of them, they may keep some religion. They keep some of the mitzvot. But they don't really learn Torah. And also, not only they don't learn Torah, they don't learn Torah deeply enough. So when they hear a speaker speaking about reincarnation, not only they don't understand, they get angry. They begin to criticize and smash, even though it's in Ari HaKadosh, was the biggest Kabbalist ever. No bigger Kabbalist than Ari. He lived 500 years ago. He wrote a whole chapter. It's called Sha'ar HaGilgulim, the Gate of Reincarnations. And over there, he explained that there are four different reincarnations in raw material, in plants, in animals. It's in amazing, in people, in all kinds of people also, measure for measure. And usually, the way a person is reincarnated to the world is based on the sins that he did not correct in his previous life. Because he's in the process of fixing what he did not fix yet. What is it like? A person came to do a job in your house. He fixed the house, but there's some problems. He cannot get paid until he finished the job. So he has to come back and finish the job. There's a leak here, there's a problem there, the wall is crooked. He has to fix it. If he came and still did not fix, what happened? He'll have to come again. There will be X amount of chances. How many chances? The judge decide. Nobody else. The judge decide. I give you one more chance to correct. Maybe I will give you one last chance. And that's it. At one point, the chances are over. The fact that we are all here, it means that we're still in a test. That's if we are with free choice. We choose between good and bad, yet. Some people come to this world and they're not choosing between good and bad. They can tell, but they have brain damage and all kinds of other things. They already came here to complete the final correction that their soul needs, and then they go to heaven, which means they are already 90, 95, or 98% corrected already. There's few more things to correct. They live short life, they leave the world, and they go to heaven. We have much, much longer journey to go. That's why we still are tested if we're going to keep Shabbat. It's the covenant between us and God. The covenant he made with us, it's the Shabbat. And he told us, you want to belong to my nation, you have to observe the Sabbath. If you don't, it's no punishment here, it's reality. You want to join my club? You want to join my group? You want to join my nation? You want to join my family? Here are the rules. Rule number one, observe the Sabbath. You don't want, it's your choice. I'm not putting a gun to your head. You're in a test. You're failing the test. Every Shabbat comes. You fail again, and you fail again, and you fail again, and eventually you die. One day you die. Nobody lives here forever. And then when a person dies, he gets judged for the good and for the bad. As the Torah says clearly, that's the big judgment day in the time of death. Just because a person get away here with all kinds of things doesn't mean Hashem forgot it or it's not recorded. It's clearly, the Torah says, that the reward, or God forbid, the punishment, comes in the afterlife. The main one. Sometimes Hashem gives us a smack here to wake up. A little tragedy, little smack, little push, money lost, all kinds of things like this to wake us up. At the same time, it gives us opportunity, CDs, books, lectures, speakers, events, Ashgacha, we see supervision, miracles in our life. The more clever a person is, the easier it is for him to make repentance. Why? Because he can analyze what's happening in his life. You see, it cannot be coincidence. Cannot be coincidence. It's no coincidence why you got to a lecture and your friend didn't come. Nothing is coincidence. It's true. You choose what to do. Nobody forces you what to do. But why did your friend offer you to come and not to someone else? Do you think it's coincidence? Of course not. The Torah explains that the merit to do tshuva, to make repentance, come from the parents, which means fathers, grandfathers, grand-grandfathers. It says in Pirkei Avot, in the Talmud, Zchut avotam omedet beyadam. The merit of their parents, could be a grandmother, could be a grand-grandmother, could be a grand-grandfather. You don't know who was your grand-grandfather was 100 years ago. Could have been a very, very big rabbi somewhere in Europe, in America, in the Arab countries. And he's coming to Hashem, and he begs Hashem, give a chance to my grand-grandson to see the truth. Give him a chance. Give him a chance. It's prayers. It's praying for Hashem. Give him a chance. And Hashem, of course, judge all the things. And sometimes a person does one mitzvah, one, and it leads him to bigger mitzvot, and to bigger, and to bigger. Why? It's called mitzvah goreret mitzvah. You do something good, small. Right away, Hashem opens you an opportunity to do something much bigger. You do another one, and another chance. It's a roll. You're on a roll. God forbid the other way around also. A person make one tiny sin, right away an opportunity to make a much bigger sin. And he does it much bigger and bigger and bigger, and he's drowning and drowning, and sometimes the person says, okay, enough. I'm keep falling. Let me make a turn. Let me go right back up. Sometimes, unfortunately, a person only go up after he crash on the floor, like a ball. He hits the floor and then he bounce back. When he reach bottom, the idea is not to reach the bottom. That's the idea, to get all the way down in order for you to go up, chaval. You know, there's a joke in Israel. Someone jumped from the Empire State Building. He's going, so somebody asked him in the 50th floor, hey, Itzik, how are you doing? He said, wow, so far, beautiful flight. Then in the 20th floor, Itzik, how are you doing? Wow, beautiful, I'm enjoying the flight. Then he reached the bottom, he's not enjoying so much. So what's the idea? Chacham enav berosho. Person see that he's falling, free fall. The idea is to stop yourself now in the 50th floor, not in the 20th. In the 20th, not in the 10th. In the 10th, not in a zero. Why? Sometimes you may be able to bounce, sometimes you break. And you're finished. No bouncing back. What guarantees you that when you reach the bottom, you'll be able to get out of there? It's not so simple. And we all see it. You can ask people who used to be in yeshivot when they're young. And they started to do one thing bad, and another, and another. And then 5 years later, you look at them one day in the street, you find them, and you cannot believe that this guy was in your yeshiva. And you say to him, what has happened to you? And then he begins to think, and he says, wait a minute. I never felt anything drastic in my drop. When I was started to fall, every day I felt a little bit. I didn't really feel a big difference. I always give this example, someone who begins to lose his hair. In the beginning, he lost 50 hairs. What's 50 hairs in a sink? Doesn't see any difference. Tomorrow, another 40, 50. The next day, every day, he doesn't really see any difference from yesterday. He looks at himself in the mirror, I still look like yesterday. Baruch Hashem. When do you feel the difference? 2-3 years later. Someone that didn't see him for 3 years, he comes, wow. You don't look like you used to look 3 years ago. Today it's in style, so it's good. You know, even people that has hair, they like to shave it off. But I'm just giving you an example that from yesterday to today, there's really no difference. But overall, there's a big major difference. Same thing, people who begins to fall in spirituality. Every day they fall a little bit. It's not from the top to the bottom in a minute. Even though there is such a thing. It's called, Yesh Adam Me'abed Olamo Berega Achad. There's a person who can lose his entire achievement, his entire saving, his entire everything in a minute. One big mistake you do, and Chas V'Shalom, you don't know, that's it. You lost billions of mitzvot in 1 minute. That's why we always have to pray to Hashem, no matter how high I can get, more and more and more, help me not to fall from there. Because to build a building may take many, many years. To knock it down may take a minute. To rebuild it again may take another 30 years. Look at the twins, September 11. How many years it took to build those twins? Who knows? In the old days, without the technology we have today, who knows how many years it took them to build it? How long did it take to knock it down? Every building, few minutes. Few minutes, it was down to the ground. How many years it takes to rebuild? Lots of work. To rebuild, lots of work. To plan it, to clean the place, until you put one brick after the other. So many people. Same thing it says in Haftarah, Shlomo HaMelech. Tens of thousands of workers he had to build Bet HaMikdash. He made, you saw in the Haftarah, he made a covenant with the from Lebanon. You know, the Goyim. Chiram, I believe, was his name. Chiram Melech Tzur. In Yerushalayim, there is Rechov Chiram. Why? Because he helped Shlomo. So, what happened? The job that Shlomo HaMelech did, I was wondering to myself, what happened if today they have to build Beit HaMikdash? I wouldn't need so many. Well, you have today tractors, you have technology, you have computers, they cut everything sharp, clean, you have good swords, you have lots of technology, you have big trucks, right? If you need to build a whole beautiful Beit HaMikdash, how many workers you need? 100, 200? They'll get a great job. How many people would need to cut the trees? You know, there's tractor today. You come to the forest, he cut the tree, and he shave all the dirt from the tree and makes the tree beautiful in moments. Right there in the forest. It's like a banana. It's peeling all the dirt from the tree. You see a beautiful tree. Then they send it to a factory right away. They do whatever they do. And all of a sudden, you have beautiful mahogany, wall units, and all that. It takes very, very easy to do it with the technology. But in their days, it was all handmade. Need so many thousands of workers and huge budget.
But you need a union also.
Well, yeah. Well, today's with the union, they may not even let you build a building. Anyway, Bezrat Hashem. But it's going to be different because with the help of Mashiach that will come, it will be a lot easier than it was. Anyway, the third temple will be the permanent one. That's it. Until this world will be over. But it will not be destroyed. First and second was destroyed because of our sins, as the Gemara says. But the third one will be final. Why? Because it will be after the Mashiach came. Once Mashiach came, the world reaches correction. No more wars. No more enemies. The Gentiles who survive love Israel, love the Torah. They come to learn Torah. Gar ze'evim keves, as the prophets say. The wolf and the goat lives together like buddies. Right? No more enemies. Which means it is all analogies, parable, how the people in the world would be. Lo yisra goy el goy cherev. The goyim will not fight. There will not be wars anymore. Why? Because everyone would understand. Bayom ha'u yeh Hashem echad u'shmo echad. There will be one God and with one name. No other possibility, no this, that, and this cult, and this religion. Everyone would announce one God and finished. You know, today they announce in Israel that where King David is buried, right next to the Kotel. If you know, you go to the Western world, 2 or 3 minutes from there, you have the cave of the Ark of King David. See, a big thing. The body is much deeper. But there's a room, you see, Kever David, Ir David, it's the city of David there. So today they announced, the church in the Vatican, they announced that they want to get position on the top floor. Why? Because they believe that JC ate his last meal over there. Somebody made up this idea that he was there for his last meal of his life, whatever. So they announced this place holy. The chief rabbi of Israel and with many other activists, they say, well, what do you mean? We have the King David here 3,000 years. That's enough already to finish the argument. Whatever happened later, it's not relevant to us. He is buried here 3,000 years. This is a holy site. Your religion started 1,100 years after King David. So what's the argument? But they're not even saying it. They said that this whole second floor, it's only 600 years old. They bring all kinds of proofs, whether it's 600 years old, whether it's whatever the case, it's not really relevant. Many people do not know that large parts of Jerusalem are owned by the Christian church. Even the Israeli Knesset complex over there, the entire mountain where the Knesset is, it's rented from the church for 100 years, 99 years. They own the land.
Which church?
The Christian church. They own lots of property in Jerusalem. Remember, the Christian occupied Jerusalem in a history, and they bought properties, and they built all these fancy churches over there, as you call in Jerusalem. You see them in many different places, you see. And because it's ancient buildings that it's important to the Christians, they were not destroyed. The Christians, in one way, they prefer that Israel will control those areas, then it falls to the hand of the Arabs. Why? If you know what happened now in Syria, almost every church they burn and break. They kicked all the Christians from large places. They destroyed the churches and they kicked them out. Why? The Muslims don't want Christians over there. They want to clean. So now, since it's a civil war, just yesterday I read an article that they cleaning one church after the other. I don't know how old those churches are, 50 years old, 100, 500, I don't really know. But in Germany, when the Nazis started to burn shuls in Europe, some of those shuls were very, very old, hundreds of years old, from 800 years ago, from hundreds of years ago. They didn't care about the value, the historical value of the building. They wanted to destroy everything that is Jewish, so destroyed everything. You know, Saddam Hussein, when he was in power, he robbed lots of Sifrei Torah and handwriting Gemaras and all kinds of Jewish things. They found lots of them. The American soldiers, they went into his palaces. They saw a lot of them. The problem is there was a lot of water damages. There was water damages. A lot of it got damaged. They brought some of it to America with them. And then, you know, they started the arguments where it should be, in Israel, in a museum, by the rabbis, and this, that. Everybody started to argue about those things. One of the things that they had was a Zohar, an old Zohar, that was written who knows how many hundreds of years ago, handwriting, an old Zohar, also with water damage. These things worth millions or tens of millions or hundreds of millions of dollars. Just to give you an idea, one page of the Rambam, with the handwriting of the Rambam from 850 years ago, which has many holes in it. It's not a complete page, was sold for $1 million in a public auction. One page. Imagine this is a whole full book. I know a case, there was a book that was written by the Chatam Sofer 250 years ago in Hungary. It was a very big Ashkenazi rabbi, Chatam Sofer. So somebody in Israel owned an original book with the handwriting of the Chatam Sofer. And his son owed a lot of money to people, so they reached a settlement with the people that they get less than what he owes them. And the way he's going to pay back after he went bankrupt is that his father will sell this Chatam Sofer book. Whatever he owed, they'll sell the book and they pay half of the debt. And everybody else will waive the rest. That was the settlement in a bed din. So they sold the book of the Chatam Sofer, a complete book with his handwriting, for $1.4 million. It's from 250 years ago, or maybe 200 years ago. The person who bought it broke it to pages. He took each page separately and sold it separately, and he doubled his money right away. Because, you know, everyone wants a page to put in the handwriting of the Chatam Sofer, such a holy, big, huge, giant Chacham. There's a very big market for it. There's auctions only for religious items. And they sell lots of items, all kinds of things. The problem with these things, it's very difficult to identify if it's real, if it's authentic, because a lot of forgeries. It's very difficult to prove. Because there's a lot of doubt, some of the things are sold much less than the real values. Because they are sold always with some kind of a doubt. Whatever. So, okay, let's move on. So now we're speaking in Moshe is sitting and judging the nation. We have a question. We have a question like this. One lawyer, he came to a butcher shop, kosher butcher shop, with his dog. And the dog started to eat from the shelf. You know, it's a pack of meat. The dog is eating the raw meat. So the owner of the butcher shop, he asked the lawyer, tell me, what's the law when the dog is eating the meat and causing me damage? Obviously, I have to throw this pack away now, or he will eat the whole thing. Is the owner responsible to pay for the damage his dog made? It's a question in Baba Kama. You know, Shor Shenagach, damages of your animals. if it was predicted to happen, not predicted, if the animals have a record. Gemara is speaking about all these things. When do you pay full damage? When do you pay half a damage? When you don't pay anything? The whole Masechet. You learn 2 or 3 years to know all the laws just about these issues. So the lawyers told him, yes, the owner of the dog has to pay. So the butcher told him, okay, $20, please. So the lawyer told him, please take it from the $300 you owe me for legal advice. Just gave me, you had a charge before the, okay, if we go business now, no problem. One question on the phone, $300. Not a joke. I one time called an immigration lawyer to ask her a question. She says, sir, we charge how much for this advice? $300. I said, but I don't want to meet. On the phone. She said, on the phone, I mean. Meeting is more expensive to make an official meeting. You're already talking $700, $800 for advice face to face to clear time for you. On the phone, it go by, they count the minute. Well, in a way, it makes sense. What's the difference? Time is time. In America, they say time is money. I always say money, it's time. Time, it's money in America. You waste my time, you're basically wasting my money or the potential to make money. But really, running after money, it's time. Money takes away all your time. And time, it's mitzvot and life of eternity. Most people, why they lose their life of eternity in the end? Why? The temptation and the desires for what? For this world. For the pleasure, for the money, for the fancy, schmancy things. Think about it. I met last week a very nice guy from Mexico City. He came to Manhattan and he, for business. So we, since he's New York, we decided to meet. We want to do some CDs in Spanish, translate them in Spanish. Because there's Baruch Hashem, lots of people who listen to those lectures also in Mexico and Argentina, all kinds of places. So, you know, speaking to him about, how did we get to Mexico all of a sudden? One thing leads to another. Huh? No, I met him, I know, but how did we get to Mexico? We started, we were, a minute ago we were by the dog, all of a sudden we're in Mexico City. Ay, ay, ay. So, you know, we go back to what we used to be. It says like this. A lawyer was sending a judge a pack of Cuban cigars. The Cuban cigars in the name of his client. Let me explain. The lawyer is representing Reuven, and Shimon is suing Reuven, and the judge is Mr. X. So what did he do? He went to a company that imports cigars, and he made an order. This is before there was credit card, so everything has to be manual. He ordered cigars to the judge named, who bought it? Shimon, the one who sued his client. And then when they followed the judge, and when the judge saw someone sending me cigar, he didn't pay attention to Shimon. He didn't know who Shimon is. You know, he has many cases in court. Okay, he took the cigar, he lit the cigar, they came, they took a picture of the judge with the cigar, and they took off the box. You see, we just caught you receiving bribe. And that's how he made his client win the case. True story, it happens. In the old days in the court. So you see, the judge receiving bribe. Now, since they were already too deep into the trial, into the case, it wasn't paid to restart the whole thing, so he dropped the allegation and finished. He dropped the lawsuit. The Gemara says, there's a question now in halacha. What happened if a person is a judge, he judged fairly, and now After a month, the person who won in court, send him donation. Rabbi, I know you have yeshiva. I really like the way you handle the cases in court. You're very fair and honest judge. Since we probably won't see each other, I don't see a problem sending donation to your yeshiva, and you send him a check. The question is, after the case is over, before the case is over, it's obvious bribe. You're not allowed, and he's not allowed to receive, and it's obvious, it's right here. You cannot take shochad, because the shochad, the bribe, blind the eyes of people. The question is, what happened after the case is finished? You want to send him a gift? Allowed or not?
Not allowed. No. We talked about this before.
Yes, so why it's not allowed? Because if you allow the judges to receive bribe, after the case, which means it's called later bribe, shochad meuchar, every time someone comes to the court, they would always favor the rich guy. Why? From the poor, no one, he won't send any donation. Only the rich can send. So if I have 10 rich against 10 poor, I always rule for the rich. Half of them will send a gratitude gift. That's why it's very good business on the side. So the Torah is not allowed. Later bribe also not allowed. Why? It's like takana. Lifnei iver lo titen michshol. What happened? It's like putting a trap in front of a blind man. Money everyone like. If you give him an opening to receive gifts without realizing, he will always, without even realizing, he will always see that the wealthy people are right. From his subconscious. You know what's the difference in East Europe, it used to be, believe it or not, that rich people used to buy the title Rabbanut. I want to be a rabbi. Okay, how much is going to cost me? He comes, he pays, they give him some fake papers, and all of a sudden he became the rabbi of the area. Or they used to buy it for their son-in-laws or for their sons. They know a little Torah, but there are many candidates, so they paid. You're looking for a rabbi for your congregation? 10 of them showed up. They submit the resume, whatever. Here I pay. How much it's going to cost me to make my son-in-law the chief rabbi? He pays. Finished. So Rav Yosef Mibrisk, he says like this. In the old generations, someone who used to have a brain, sechel, intelligence and brain, and knew Torah, he used to get the job of a rabbi. Even though he did not have a dollar in his pocket. Someone from yeshiva, he knows a lot of Torah, doesn't have any money. Today, if he has a full pocket and an empty head, he gets the job. That's what Rav Yosef Mibrisk says. In the old days, in order for you to be a chacham of the community, it's not my words, it's Rav Yosef Mibrisk. This is what he said. In the old days, you could be empty pocket. Rabbi, how much you worth? $2. Not a problem, it's not an issue. You know a lot of Torah. Chazak u'baruch. Full head, empty pocket. Today, sometimes, not all the time, chas v'shalom. Sometimes, once in a blue moon, full pocket, empty head also. Not enough just to know Torah, by the way. Sometimes you know a lot of Torah, but you need to be also, to be clever. To be clever. Like I told you the story with Rav Yaakov Mutzafi, he was a judge in a court, Rabbi Yaakov Mutzafi. And one time he saw that two guys came, and one claimed that his friend owed him money, I lend him 40,000 lirot in Israel, it was my pension money, now he denies it. So he saw that there's no witnesses, no shtar, no agreement, no nothing. So what happened? So in the end he said to him, listen, really based on the Torah, I cannot find you guilty. There's no evidence against you. However, tomorrow I want you to come at 9 o'clock in the morning to the Beit Din, to the court, and receive, what are you gonna receive? We're gonna bring a body of someone who will die tonight from the Chevrat Kadisha. I want you to hold the hand of the body. And if you really stole the money, you will feel that the dead body was closing on you tighter and tighter by the minute. And then we will know that you're lying. It's something Kabbalistic. You don't have to agree if you don't want. But this is a way for us to prove that you're clean 100%. This guy thinking to himself, what is he talking about? Dead body is gonna tie. Dead body cannot move his hand. So, okay. Plus, he doesn't have a choice. What is he gonna say? No, I don't wanna come. Obviously, it will make him look even more suspicious. So he came the next day. He see all of a sudden the Chevrat Kadisha, they bring a body, they bring him into the court. So he said to him, listen, you sure you want to do it? Because it's really a life risk. He's already stuck in a situation. He said, okay, yeah. So hold the hand of the dead body, hold it. And, you know, he said to me, repeat after me, I never took money from this guy ever. I don't know what he wants. I don't know him anything. He begins to repeat. Then he feels that the hand is closing tighter and tighter and tighter by the minute. It's really hurting. So he said to him, Rabbi, tell him to leave my hand. So what do you mean tell him? He's a dead person. You're lying, right? He said to him, no. He said, listen, if you're going to be another minute, Chas v'Shalom, he can kill you. It's not a joke. That's it. There's no point, no return now. The only way it would stop if you say the truth. So he said, yeah, I took the money. How much? 40,000 lira. Where? This? When? That? Everything he admitted. You're going to pay it back? Yes. Today I'll pay it back. Okay. He said to the dead person, get up. And he got up and everyone was hugging. It's a true story. It happened in Yerushalayim. This is what the Torah wants from a judge. Don't just go by the book. Today, the judge come to court, it's a day of work. Go by the regulations, by the rules. You know, the warrant wasn't reached legally. Everybody knows he's a murderer. He lets him go free, knowing this tomorrow he's going to kill another one. Rapist, murderer, whatever. Why? We go by the regulations. That's not what Hashem wants. Hashem wants the judge to really search for justice, which means justice means not to let the murderer back on the street or all the things that are happening, unfortunately. You know, so that's why he wanted the judges to use their head and to be clever. The Rama, Rabbi Moshe Iserlish, 500 years ago, he's the chief Ashkenazi rabbi of Europe who wrote comments on Shulchan Aruch. He was also a judge. And again, two people who are fighting for money, and he knew that the one person is right, but there's no evidence. There's no witnesses, no bill, no nothing. So he saw that he has a beautiful silver box with tobacco. You know, this brown tobacco that people put in their nose? So the Rama said to him, he's winning the case. So the Rama said to him, oh, I see you have good, pure tobacco. Can I use some? So the guy think, oh, the chief of the court is asking me for my tobacco. That means I'm in a very good situation. So he took from the tobacco, he pretended he used it. Of course, he didn't use it. But then, as the case is going on and on and on, he said to his helper, run to this guy's wife, to the house, and tell her that your husband is in big trouble in court, and all the jewelry he stole a week ago, put everything in a bag and give it to you and bring it right to the court before it's going to be too late for him to confess. And the proof that the husband sent you is that he gave his personal tobacco box as a proof that he's really sending me. He told to the messenger. The messenger ran. He said to her, listen, your husband is in a big problem. He said to collect all the jewelry he stole that day. Put everything in a bag and give it to me quickly because otherwise he's going to have... So she said to him, well, I don't know you. She said, don't worry, here, he gave me his tobacco. You see, tobacco? He gave it to me as a proof. No cell phone. Cell phone, she calls him up. 500 years ago, she looks at her husband tobacco. It's obviously true. How did he reach my husband tobacco, this guy? She gave all the jewelry. He brought it to the Rama, and the guy continued to stand there and to lie. And he said to him, here is your tobacco, go, goodbye, shalom. Here, you take all your jewelry. This guy is looking. How did you get it, Rabbi? Hocus pocus. They use their head. When the judge see, sometimes he know one guy is right, the other one is lying. It's very difficult sometimes to prove. Plus, you know, the judge today, you know what he would tell you? I'm not a lawyer. I'm not an investigator. I'm not the police. I cannot do their job. And you'll say, well, he has a point. Well, what do you expect the judge to do? To do the investigation and to help the police how to convict the murderer? So the answer is, in a secular court, everyone has his job. you cannot push your nose into the police and this and the FBI and you know, everyone with this, whatever they do. But in the Torah, justice is above everything. Doesn't matter who will prove the justice. If the judge know that he's a murderer, just because it's not my job to prove it, I'm going to let him go? It's above everything. That's what Hashem wants from the judge, to reach the justice. It doesn't matter how, as long as the justice was reached. You know, there was one case, we're speaking about court cases. There was one murderer that is about, his court case is about to complete it, to get completed. Just before the jury reached their verdict, his lawyer said to the people there, in 10 minutes, the real murderer will walk in the door and all of you will see how wrong you are. Everyone looks at him. 10 minutes from now, it's 12 noon now, 12:10, the real murderer would walk in. And you see that you're about to convict an innocent person. So they all look at the judge. So judge said, no problem, we'll sit here and wait 10 minutes. Everyone's talking, the judge, quiet. Everyone stare at the door. 12:10, the murderer didn't come. 12:11, nothing. The judge looks at the lawyer. He said, I don't understand, you're playing games here? He said to him, Your Honor, all of you believed me when I said the real murderer would come, which means you're not sure that my client is the murderer. The law here, you have to convict only beyond any reasonable doubt. You have a serious doubt. If in 1 minute you all look at the door, that means you're far away from being sure that my client is a murderer. How are you going to execute him? You execute a person when you're not sure if he's the murderer? So right away, everyone started to talk, the jury, the lawyer had a brilliant idea. So the judge said to all the jury, go to the room, let's discuss this. After 2-3 hours, everyone was sure, that's it, this guy got away. They came out and they said, the jury found the defendant guilty. How can it be guilty after such a doubt? So they said, how? So one woman, she said, after the trial, when everyone looked at the door, I did not look at the door. I stared in the eyes of this defendant. He is the only one in the courtroom that did not look at the door. Everyone looked at the door, but he didn't, because he knew there's no real murderer would come. He know he did it. If he would also stare at the door for 10 minutes, I would get convinced. But since he did not look at the door, I knew it's him. And that's how I convinced all the other jury, and we have enough evidence against him. And in the end, they reached the right verdict. The parasha continue. Kol tomar lebet Yaakov etaged lebnei Yisrael. Chazal say, bet Yaakov means Chazal, the sages. The Chazal say, bet Yaakov means the women. The women. First talk to the ladies, and then talk to the men. You know, we have a rule in the Torah. When the Torah say, tomar, and taged, what's the difference? Omer, magid. Tomar, taged, what's the difference? In modern Hebrew, you ask the professor in the Hebrew university, he say to you, mila nirdefet, similar word, no difference. Tomar, taged, what's the difference? There's no such thing in Judaism. Every word has a unique thing about it. Every word. So it says like this. It says, tomar means in a soft way. Taged means strictly. So it says like this. Kol tomar lebet Yaakov. When you speak to the ladies, don't be too aggressive. Their nature is softer. They cannot take aggression. That's, by the way, the reason why ladies cannot be witnesses in court. The Torah says, Isha psula le'edut. A woman cannot be a witness. And also cannot be a judge, which means to rule cases of life and death and things like this. Why? Because the pressure that you put on a woman affecting her a lot faster and stronger than when you put the pressure on a man that is a big Talmid Chacham. Let me give you an example. if a woman, she's a witness, and a gangster caught her, they grabbed her, they kidnapped her, and they put her for even 1 hour in a room. And they say to her, you know, if you will testify, well, Chas v'Shalom do something horrible to you. Right away, she thinks about her body, what they're going to do to her. She cannot take the pressure. Immediately, she cannot take it. Also, physical torture. Even though today we all like women, because we're much more spoiled than 2,000-3,000 years ago. But physical pressure, they cannot take. But what's the real main reason why women cannot be? Because when they sit in a court, the lawyer who investigates them speaks very harshly and put down the witnesses, as you all see in a court. And when a woman with a mother of a children, she sits there and they begin to bring all the trash about her and all the dirt, that's Bizayon, this is Bat Israel. This is the daughter of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And non-modest issues can rise and all kinds of other things. So Hashem did not want his daughters to be on a stand under cross investigation and all kinds of aggression. So he dismissed them. It's not a punishment, it's a privilege. Told them, I don't want you to be bothered with testimonies. Not that they're not reliable. Of course she's reliable, what? Not that she's not smart. She's smart just as much or more, the Torah says. That's not the reason why she cannot be a witness. Same thing, children. A little kid, 11 years old. Doesn't mean he's not smart. He can describe what he saw. He learns very beautifully, but he's not mature enough to handle the pressure. That's why Hashem says, you know what? It's better not to open the door. Not to open the door, because then automatically what's going to be? It's going to be constant attack against all the female witnesses. I don't want it in the court. I don't want. It's not disrespect for the mother of the family to put her on the stand and start speaking to her, and she begins to cry because women are very emotional. So now we understand a little bit more why women cannot be. Not like some people try, Chas v'Shalom, to twist the truth of the Torah and say, oh, Judaism is a chauvinist. It's against women, or women do not have equal rights, and all kinds of things. I have a whole lecture that I made once, the status of a Jewish woman in Judaism, which was a very big hit. It was a very big hit because it was discovering to a lot of people things they did not know about women. They always thought, women are this and men is like this. Actually, that lecture turned everything around to the eyes of many, many thousands of people, because they got the point now that not only the women are not less, Hashem put in their hand such responsibility of raising the children, which is the future of Hashem's nation. The children are the new generation, the future. Without education to the children, the Judaism will be dying eventually. Another generation or two. If you don't put the children in the hand of faithful mother to raise them, to give them good example of modesty, or how she prays, how she is devoted to the house, she's supportive and all that. And you can see right away today, kids, they need a father very much. It's very important for them to grow up with a father. But it's much more important to have a mother. Even by secular courts, they understand when parents get divorced that the mother should have the kids. Even though maybe the mother is not right in the arguments with the father. By the goyim, by the Gentile court, even if the mother cheated on her husband, which according to the Torah is a very, very big sin, even then they give her the kids. Not because they think she's right, or she's innocent, or she deserves a prize. No. Because they look at what's good for the kids. They say, okay, the father is right. Father is innocent. The father is a miserable human being that look what tragedy happened to him. But what's the point of giving him the kids? What is he going to do? He's going to work, he's running, he has to dress them in the morning, take them to school, cook for them, change their diapers, take them to the... This is not a job for men. However, we see sometimes that the men fight to get custody. Why? Because first of all, even though they know It's better for the children to stay with the wife. It's a matter of ego. They don't really think what's the best for the children is what my revenge desire is telling me to do. A hero, an honest, decent person should look what's good for my children, not what's good for my evil inclination and my desire to take revenge against her. What's good for the children right now? She wasn't a good wife, but she's a good mother. Better for the children to be with her. However, if it comes to cases that the mother destroyed the kids spiritually, which means their father is very religious, is learning and keeping the laws, and the mother is not. It happens sometimes. Maybe sometimes she was and she went down, and she's starting to become an apikorsit, and she's speaking against the Gemara and against Halacha, and modesty issues. And then they get divorced. That's a different story. Why? Because if she goes to a rabbinical court and they see that the father is religious and the mother is not, they won't want the children to be raised by a woman that would teach them to violate the rules of Hashem, which is very understandable. Even in Monsi, there was a case of one Hasidic man that his wife went off the derech. She became Hashem Irachem. And I went to a non-Jewish judge. I think, if I'm not mistaken, the judge was a woman, non-Jewish woman. And she ruled that the children will go to the father. The father will gain custody, even though it wasn't a religious Jewish judge. So they asked, why? How can you give? Usually the mother gets custody. She said, they raised the children in the beginning of their marriage according to Judaism. It's not the interest of the children. She's not going into the argument and the debate which religion is correct and which one is good or not. That's not the job of the secular judge. She only look at her as a judge in a family court. What's good for the children? She would have done the same thing whether it was Christianity or Islam or anything else, not to make mistake here. But she say, if the children were raised in a certain way and now you're going to flip them over because she decided not to be religious, it's not for the interest of the children to mess their head up like this. They have already one line in their life. They're satisfied. They're happy. They even ask the kids. They like the way they were until now. They say yes. Gain custody. Sometimes people gain custody in illegal ways. Bribes, money, politics, power. They know someone. They know the mayor, they know the head of the police, who knows what. And you know, there's a lot of corruption, unfortunately. In the end, whatever the corruption does, we always have to remember one thing. What is it? In the end, we will all stand in front of Hashem. Speak Lashon Hara about innocent people. We'll have to face the consequences of what happened from it. And it can be a huge tragedy. One thing leads to another. You frame people, you motzi shemra, you make all kinds of things, you step them in the back, you want to make yourself higher by putting him down. Lots of things. The corruption in the world is reaching levels that I don't know if we ever reached in history. There was always corruption. It didn't start today. We see what Moshe had to go through in the 40 years that he led the nation of Israel in the desert. How many political arguments, how many people were fighting for honor and jobs and power and ego and all kinds of bad advices and rebellions and all kinds of things. So it existed always. We see in the Tanakh the immorality that some generations had. It's nothing new. Don't get me wrong, it always existed to some extent. But it seems today that the Satan won over us completely in any field, any aspect, a total knockout. It's so bad, that today they announce on the Israeli news all over, it's all over, so everyone already knows about it, that the son of Benjamin Netanyahu has a girlfriend from Norway, non-Jewish ones. Millions of Jews marry non-Jewish people and violate one of the rules of the Torah. Everybody understands if a person was in relationship with a non-Jewish woman it's one sin, but when he marries her, he makes the sin a lot worse. Everybody understand? That's already what the Torah emphasized so many times, to be very careful about it. But the absurd, what they wrote today in the article was that just last Shabbat, Netanyahu was in Switzerland, and he had to walk, I think, an hour or 2 hours in a freezing weather on Shabbat with his wife. I can imagine the heel she had to walk 1 or 2 hours in the freezing weather. The Israelis are very sensitive for cold because they grow in hot and humid weather. They come here, even 50, 60 degrees, they freeze. Very difficult for them to adjust to the cold weather here. Imagine there, it's also very cold in Europe. So they had to walk 2 hours from the Jewish community of Switzerland, of Davos. They invited them to be the guest of honors for some, I guess, in one of the shuls. It was on Shabbat. So they had to walk the entire ride not to be mechalel Shabbat befaresia. And not Shabbos observant. No, let's not fool ourselves. Not Netanyahu and not his wife. But in public, you already the prime minister of a Jewish state. It will invite a lot of criticism. Yeah, if 20-25% of your nation are religious people, you hurt their feelings, you will come to represent the Jewish state, all kinds of things like this. So somebody wrote today, he walks 2 hours not to be mechalel Shabbat in public, and then either before or after, shortly before or shortly after, he comes to the Norway minister, one of the Norway minister, and break to her that his son is dating a woman from Norway. So somebody wrote today, God, this is what he wrote, not me, him. He wrote, please make Iran throw an atomic bomb on us already. It's about time. We cannot live here anymore. That's what he wrote, somebody. Somebody in the comments wrote today, please make it happen already. Why? What's the point of living? Look what's happened to us. As a nation, as people, look at the morality of the ethic. Look what's going on. Look at the corruption. Look at the government. Look at the Lashon Hara everywhere. This is what's on the mind of that person. So you know what? Maybe it's better. It will be 1 second and it's all over and finished. Not that I justify it, but I'm just saying, just the fact that one Jew already wrote it in public, and many people agree with him over there, what does it tell you? That people already lost the desire to live in such a corrupted world that we live in. However, that's not the right approach. Why? Even the sword is on the neck of a person moment before it's all over, should not give up on the mercy and on the chance that he still has. What? We have to look at us as a part of a large unit. We have the nation, and we are one screw in the system. We are one wire. We are one transformer. Everyone has a job in a Jewish nation. Some has more critical jobs than others. But the system sometimes, even if you take one screw that worth 10 cents, a system of $10 million will not function, right? If there is one little wire in a cord that you put inside the outlet, one tiny wire inside from the three is disconnected, a $10 million machine will not function, will not work. The whole $10 million that you prepared, without, if you cannot replace this little wire or corner or fix it, it's worthless. So the entire nation of Israel, yes, some people look greater than others. Some people have a more responsible job, responsibility, leader of the army, leader in a government, big rabbis, and all kinds of things like this. But you don't know. Sometimes an ordinary person, even he is critical for the world. He is critical for the nation. So we have to look at ourselves as a unit. I'm a part of a large unit. Okay. If the unit is not functioning, malfunction, it's not functioning, I also have to remember that I'm also an individual. I'm a unit on my own. It's a unit inside a unit. Just because the large unit doesn't work and there's a lot of corruption and problems, I'm still going to be judged for who I am. I won't be able to use it as an excuse. Ma, what do you want, God? The world is so bad, everything is this, and look at the religion, and look at the politics. And, you know, I heard today the two people they have a mutual grandson. They're two important people, without going into details. So the grandson had a bar mitzvah. They don't want to meet each other in the bar mitzvah. So for 1 week, Mama said, to cry when you hear these stories. For 1 week, they're fighting how they will divide the bar mitzvah to half and half. Let's say the bar mitzvah start from 8 in the evening until 11 at night, let's say, in a catering hall. So from 8 to 9:30, whose shift is going to be? And from 8:30 to 11, whose shift is going to be? So they reach an agreement that they won't be at the bar mitzvah at the same time. That one will come from 8 to 9:30 and leave, and one would come from 9:30 to 11 and leave. After they reach that agreement, of course, they don't speak directly to each other. Same thing like Kamtza u Bar Kamtza, they're messengers. Now, the argument is, who is going to be first? Which means, who is more important? The first one is more important. I came and I left. I left because I didn't want to see his face. Not he left because he didn't want to see his face. To be continued. We'll see what's going to be with that. The poor kid. They understand what's happening today? What is it all? Ego. Ego. Two people fight. Who's going to pray in a shul? Why are they fighting? Because each one of them has a yortzeit. Yortzeit means the memorial day of their father or the mother. So it's a tradition is that when on the day of the yortzeit, the person that his mother or father passed away, they pray in a shul for everyone. Shliach tzibur, it's called. Chazan, cantor. So two people are arguing. No, I have a yortzeit. The other one said to the gabbai, also, I have a yortzeit. Sometimes it gets to a situation that they almost fist fight. They're willing to kill each other. What a clever person would do right away? Right away, tell to the other person, forget about my yortzeit. You come first. Why? What do you think Hashem is more happy with? That you fight and grab it, or you say to him, you go first? To be a shliach tzibur, it's a rabbinical law. Not even, it's a custom, which helps the neshamot. The Ari HaKadosh, which was the biggest Kabbalist ever, wrote a list of things. What helps the soul? And he did not mention to be a chazan. It's not in his list. This has come really more from Ashkenazi tradition, from the Rama. The Ashkenazi were not following Kabbalah so much, especially the Rama. He wasn't known as a Kabbalist. He was a big Chacham. The Ari was a Kabbalist. Even Rabbi Yosef Karo, that wrote the Shulchan Aruch, is not known as a Kabbalist. Live in the same generation like the Ari, but in Shulchan Aruch he wrote halacha from the Talmud, from the Rishonim. That's it. Did not mix Kabbalah hardly at all. There's some Kabbalistic things in a Shulchan Aruch, but hardly. Halacha, it's halacha. There are many midrashim and asmachtot and Kabbalah things and secrets. We go over the Talmud, what's mentioned in the Talmud and in the Rishonim, and you posek in the Shulchan Aruch what to do, what not to do, that's it. So what is it? First, it's only a custom. To give up, to avoid a fight between two Jews and to cause chilul Hashem in a shul, is a very big mitzvah from the Torah. Last thing Hashem wants is machlokot and arguments and fights. You understand what I'm saying here or not? So, if Hashem will see that you give in, here, you go first, no problem. What do you think? Who is going to get a bigger help for his father that passed away? The one who made the fight and grab it and is now praying? Or the one who say, well, of course, I'm giving in. You do, well, we're going to make a fight over it. It's so obvious. So why hardly anyone gives in? If it's so obvious. Because the Satan also has his share. Satan, he said to me, yeah. It's true that it's good to give in. And it's true that Hashem loves it. But think what everyone here will think about you. That you're a weak character. They put you down. tomorrow and there's something new. Either way, the Satan balanced the situation. What do you think? Otherwise, who would make a fight about something like this? It's not logical. Very large portion of the people fight for it. The Chazan, it's not fair to the Gabbai. It's not fair. I'm more years in the shul than him. I help to build the place more than him. I donate more money. What does he do for the shul? Right away, the shul split to two different groups. And another 20 million went down to the garbage because next month they have to build another shul, the other group. So now, one shul that had 300 people, and they already spent 15 million to build it. Now 120, 140 moves in, and they build another one, and now it's going to be 120 here, 180 here. Two buildings. Another $20 million went down to build another place. Not that I have anything against shuls. Shul, it's important. It's to pray in minyan. It's community. It's make connections in a community. It's very important. It's so important that it says that the Beit Din can force people to give donation to build a shul. If there's no shuls in a place, they can force you to pay. Just like the IRS force you to pay taxes, they don't ask you. The Jewish court can force a person to pay to build a shul if there's no shul. Why? The community needs to get together. Sometimes it's funerals, sometimes it's bar mitzvah, chuppah, lectures, kedusha, birkat kohanim, tefillah betzibur, kriyat haTorah, classes. There's a lot of nice things happening there. You need a public place. It's true, you can pray at home. If you have a big room in a home, and you can make the house, one room is a shul. That's how they used to do it all the generations. What do you think? Not always they had money to build. But everybody understands that when it's a public place, and everyone gathered there together, it's beautiful and it's with harmony. So the Torah says, speak to the lady softly, not too aggressive. Same thing husband to his wife. Don't be too aggressive. In Hebrew they say, Al tiyeh tzodek, tiyeh chacham. Don't be right, be clever. You can be right and be divorced and dead. Or you can be clever, okay, so you lost the argument, but you save your marriage, or you save your future, or you save a family. Don't always look to be right. Sometimes you're right. And whatever, I'll give you an example. A father found out his son stole money from him. Very bad feeling. He can confront him and find him guilty, and the boy won't have anything to say. Not enough testimonies that he's guilty. Well, what's going to be? This boy will be so embarrassed, he will run away from home and become a junkie eventually and lose him for good. So what's better, to be right and lose him for good, or to pretend you didn't see it and move on? Depend on the case. If you know your son, you can take him on the side and speak to him and he will apologize, it's fine, fine. If you know he's not going to be able to tolerate the guilt and the embarrassment or whatever, what's going to be? You know, there was one case that a boy in yeshiva had some kind of a anger attack. He ripped all the sidurim, all the gemarot to pieces. Everyone in the school said, throw him out of here, it's peri adam. Everyone to throw him away to the street. And of course, the rabbi knew if I'm throwing him out now after what he did in an anger attack, no yeshiva ever will accept him after such a thing. You don't have to just think how I get rid of him. You have to think what's going to happen with him after. You find him another yeshiva, fine. No, it's a rabbi miuto. Sometimes after you throw him for something that everyone would add salt and pepper to the story, say they burned the Sefer Torah inside the ark, because people like to make things more juicy. You have to think, what's going to be with this neshama? Is it justified for 1 hour of horrible thing that he did that he's going to lose the rest of his life? He won't be able to marry a kosher Jewish woman and to have a kosher home. Many people in a moment of weakness can do horrible thing and then an hour later they regret it deeply and they will never repeat it again. But if you go and focus on the 1 hour, you destroy them. So what happened? he spoke against the whole pressure. And he said, no, I'm not throwing him out. And he made him stand on a chair in front of the whole thing and apologize and give a speech why what he did was wrong. And then later, after years, that kid became a huge rabbi. So he said that the best decision he made in his life is not throwing this kid out of the yeshiva. Because who knows who he would be, the head of the mafia. Think about it. You know, they published on the news 3 days ago that one woman that her son got kicked out of yeshiva killed himself. So now she wrote a big thing blaming the rabbi who threw him out. And she said, just when there is a problem, right away you press the button and you get rid of the problem. Maybe you could have done more. She wrote, I don't know if she's blaming directly, but she wrote such a painful letter which describes a serious problem that we have in our communities today. I told you last week, they announced in Bnei Brak, 10% of the boys are dropping from yeshivot and go off the derech. Do you know what it means, 10%? It's a tragedy that cannot be described in words. If you have a class of 40 kids, four of them you lose in front of your eyes. It's horrible. And there's another epidemic, the divorce. They're making a big committee now, in committees, trying to plan how to try to defeat this epidemic. Why? Almost every couple who get married now, after a few months, wants to get divorced. It's horrible what's happening now. My friend told me on Shabbat, you know this guy? Yeah. Did you hear in the last year two of his daughters got married? I said, yeah, I heard. They announced. He said, both of them already are home. In 1 year. You know what pain for the father? You know what a pain it is? And if there's a kid involved, it's even more painful. You see your daughter with a little baby in your home for the next 5, 10 years, who know what. And what's the reason of the divorce? Most of the time, lack of preparation for the marriage. Nobody prepared them to get married. They didn't know what the real life is. Usually it's kids who grew up in houses like princes and princesses, and everything was done for them. They're not ready for the life. Getting divorced is not just a love affair between a man and a woman. It's a different thing. There's other things involved here. It's a partnership, it's building a home, it's responsibilities. It's lots of difficulties, constant difficulties, constant support. Husband has to be a psychologist, has to be a helper, has to be so many things. And a woman, same thing. The woman, she's a psychologist of the man, and he's a psychologist of her. Lots of support. To learn how to put down ego, what to say, what not to say, what to get the parents involved with, which is usually nothing. Best advice, never to report to the in-laws or to the parents any problem. Come see your daughter, come see your son, look how he behaves. It's not going to get you anywhere. 2, 3, 5 cases, the family is also against you. And now even if he wants to make peace with you, they won't let. They had it. They don't see the nice moments. They don't see all the great things he does. They only heard 5 times in the last 6 months that he screamed, that he yelled, that he cursed, that he left the house, that he went with his friends and he came back at 2 o'clock at night. They heard 5 cases like this. What's the beginning? Come home. Before you have children, it's better you come home now. We'll talk to the rabbi to make a get. Why is it? 1, lack of preparation for marriage. 2, nobody wants to work on his character and his midot. So right, the easy way out. That's not an easy way out. What do you think, the next time will be better? I won't get it. Do you have the divorce right now, the fight is a symptom of a problem that exists. The fighting, the cursing, the violence, whatever happens, it's the symptoms. It's not the problem. The problem is what caused these symptoms. The person has headache and fever. That's not the disease. What do you have? I have fever, I'm sick. No. Fever, it's the alert. There's an infection somewhere in the body that will kill you in 3 days if you don't wake up, if you don't fight against it. The fever, the headache, whatever you have, it's the symptoms, the fights, the arguments, the complaints, the violence, all these things, it's the symptoms of the problem that exists, which is much deeper than this. You don't come and teach him how not to scream, how not to do this and this and that. You have to locate the problem. The problem could have been prevented if you prepare them to marriage. So I always say it, many times I say, I had the money and the time, I would open a college. Not to be a pharmacist. Not to learn computers. There's plenty of colleges for that. A unique college, teach marriages. Teach how to get married, how to be a husband, how to be a wife, the psychology of the woman, psychology of the man, what partnership means, obligations, raising children, how to handle in-laws. What do you do in a case like this? What do you do in a case like this? Your wife is spending too much money. Where do you know when to say enough, when you have to pretend you don't see? There's a lot of issues. Hundreds of issues needs to be taught separately. What do you do in a case like this? What do you do when there's a mess? What do you do when the children do like this? What do you do? So many things to learn. To be a doctor, it's easier than to be a husband or a wife. So much to learn about the house. So much to learn. Just before we finished, the Torah was given to us. The Torah is 54 chapters. 54 parashot. Parashot, which means it's divided to 54 names of chapters. But each parasha includes few chapters in it. So the Torah divided to 187 chapters. 5,845 verses. 81,404 words. 304,805 letters. Almost 305,000 letters. It's a lot. If somebody asks you, what did we really get in Har Sinai? The answer, the Ten Commandments, the entire Oral Torah, and the written Torah from the beginning until the chapter of Yitro, Jethro, which means everything that happened up to now. It's written already. Why? It's not going to affect the future. That's it. It happened. It's history already. From now on, the next 40 years that we're going to be in a desert and what's going to be to us, what's going to happen to us, wars, this, it will be written as we progress. Every few months or few years, Hashem called Moshe to Oel Moed, write another chapter until the last day of his life. He concluded the Torah as an argument in the Gemara if he finished until the last letter or the last 8 verses Yoshua wrote because it's described the death of Moshe. One opinion that he was crying and writing about his death, which is coming in minutes. And one opinion that he died and Yoshua actually concluded it. One way or the other doesn't matter. One thing we do know that Moshe wrote 13 Sifrei Torah in one day. Instead of 20 years, it took him one day. How can it be a miracle? Why are you surprised? If bread is falling from heaven, it's also a miracle. The Red Sea splits, it's also a miracle. Blood all over Egypt is also a miracle. It's 100 miracles described in the Torah. They all saw in their eyes. It's written in the Torah what happened to them in the last year. So one more miracle. What's the big deal? You don't ask about miracles. If you know my entire debate with a Christian priest, a professor, I did not attack him even once about the miracles that described in the New Testament. Some miracles out there are looking very, very ridiculous or hard to believe. That J.C. fed 500 people with one piece of bread. All kinds of things like this. Why I did not attack? Because that's not a legitimate argument. Why? Because miracles happen. It's a fact. How do we know? The Torah described miracles, and we see miracles in our own eyes. If Saddam shot a missile and it fell on the main gas central station in Israel, and after years of argument, few days before the missile fell, they finally decided to shut it and to move to the new location, which was ready for years. But they refused to move to the new location. They did not want to move. And then after fights, few days before, they shut the main gas pipe that would kill more than a million Israelis immediately. More than a million would die. If thousands of big rocks, size of a melon, fell from the mosque on top of the Western world in the holiday of Sukkot when there was 20,000 Jews. And if you see the video, you will never believe how can it be that 20,000 men and women and old people, like sardines, standing over there in a prayer of the Chol HaMoed Sukkot, and the Arabs prepare rocks like this weeks in advance. And you can see it on the video. I cannot argue. You see it in your own eyes. How heavy a rain of rocks, not little stones, big rocks falling from so high. And everyone was like sardine. Cannot fit a needle between them. That's 20,000 people in the Western world. You know how crowded it is? And now everything started to fall and everyone started to run. And people were falling just from running, stepping on children and on old people. Should have been 100 or 200 dead people there. Just from choking, just from stepping on people's head. In England, in UK, they have soccer games and people fight and they push and the police come. 80 people died, 20 people died, 14 people died just from the pressure. Trying to run from the gas that they shoot or whatever. Not one person died. Not person got injured. Unbelievable. Such miracle. Do you think this miracle is smaller than the Exodus of Egypt? Why? Why? How can it be thousands of big rocks falling and not one head cracked open? You know why? A minute before, there was 150 Kohanim. They did Birkat Kohanim. A minute before. As soon as the Birkat Kohanim finished, all the rocks fell. Rabbi Uri Zohar made a video about it. He put in his video that part, how the rocks are falling and how the floor looked after the attack. You could not see the floor. Only a big rocks like this you saw. And he said, no, look at how many rocks. Is it possible that one person did not get injured here? Not one person died? How can it be? That's also a very big miracle. How many people became religious from this miracle? 50, 20, 100? That's it. Why not the entire nation of Israel? Why? They didn't see such miracles that the minute before was Birkat Kohanim, now one person got hurt? There's many, many hundreds of miracles like this. Many miracles. Did I tell you the story? How one time I came home and I found my wife calling to order checks. Did you hear that story or no? And I said to her, no, let me go and search for checks. Maybe it's too expensive. What is this? Every check was almost a quarter. What piece of paper so expensive? Need hundreds of checks. And I Googled and I found a place and I called the place. And someone picks up in customer service. And I told him how much the check, it was a quarter of a price. I said, okay, let's order from you. So I told him the order, 600 checks, number, catalog number, such and such. And I said, does that include shipping? He said, no. I said, oh, probably here is the catch. How much the shipping is? He told me, depend to where. I said, to Muncie, New York. So the guy said to me, where in Muncie? What difference does it make? Shipping is the same to all over Muncie. It's a small town. So I said to myself, maybe it's a scam. He's gonna get my address tomorrow. He's going to come rob me. So I told him the corner, the intersection. So I told him the intersection next to my home. So he told me, oh, you're next to Rav Schlesinger Shul. Come tonight at 8:30 and I'll give you the checks. I said to him, you also from Monsi? I found him between thousands of ads and Google. Thousands of ads. He said to me, yes. I come next door to your home to the shul every night for the shiur of the rabbi. So I ask him, where in Muncie you live? You thought the miracle is finished, no? It's only starting now. So I told him, where it was you lived? He said, in Bates Drive. I said, Bates Drive? Amazing, I used to live there. What number? No, where does he live? The same building I lived. Same building. Next day, I couldn't go in the night because I'm in lecture. Next day, I went to his house. I pick up the CD. I look at my old apartment there. What's the odds something like this would happen? Coincidence. What's? That's enough. What, you need more proofs than that, that Hashem runs the world? What? The miracles is that I save $50 or $40? Of course not. What's the miracle? That Hashem wanted to wake me up. See? I do whatever I want here. Where do I? You come, you think, you search from 7 billion people in the world. Every other American print checks that has printer today to make extra money on the side. Thousands of names. Which one I made you pick? Someone who lives where you used to live. It's a wake-up call. And there's hundreds like this in our life. We choose to ignore most of them or to forget them after an hour. That's why I always say, when you come to a good lecture and the speaker woke you up, don't wait for tomorrow. Right now, make, accept on yourself, A, B, C. I'm starting this Shabbat, I'll keep, that's it. Tomorrow morning, I take the tefillin, clean the dust, and I begin to put. I don't have tefillin, you come to me, I have very good tefillin, half the price of what they sell in stores. Best quality, best parshiot, half a price, with all the extras. Same thing mezuzot. So, you have no excuses. Well, you have now, Baruch Hashem, everything you need. The question is, do you want to do the right thing or not? Do you want it or you don't want to do it? Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra asked, and this is really the last thing for today, Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra say, why Hashem say, Anochi Hashem Elokechem asher hotzeti etchem me'eretz Mitzrayim? I am the God that took you out of Egypt. Why he did not say, I'm the God that created you? I'm your creator. I'm your creator. What's more convincing? That you hear a voice come from heaven, dear Moshe, dear Yitzchak, I'm the God that made you. Or I'm the God who took you out of Israel and brought you to New York. What's more convincing? So the Ibn Ezra asked, why Hashem say, I took you out of Egypt? The answer is, it's nothing special. He also created the Gentiles. He also created 2 million different species in nature. He created billions of galaxies. He created a lot of things. What's so unique about it that you come to me, hey, I want to reach my arm to make a deal with you. What? I give you oxygen. Okay, you give the whole world oxygen. I took you out of Egypt because I wanted to make you my son, to make a covenant with you. And I made all these miracles in a creation only for you. I did not do it for any one of the nations and not for the species and not for any other world. Only for you. I interfere with my laws. I change everything just for you. Oh, that's a very big, impressive thing. I took you out of Egypt for only one reason. What do you think? To lay on a beach in Acapulco? For what I took you out of Egypt? To have a hearing? To make a goatee beard with a earring over here? And a horse tail in your back? Why do you think I took you out of Egypt? To dance like this naked in a party? Huh? To buy a nice sport car? I was in Miami. This cute guy that was driving me around. Really nice tzaddik. Sometimes you meet people, they're engraved in your heart for a long time. So, his name is Yosef Uliel, very nice kid. So I goes to his building where his parents live, he showed me a car there in the lobby. So you see this car? $2 million car. $2 million car? Private jet costs less. I said, what's so special about this car? He told me Bugatti. First time in my life, Baruch Hashem, I came to this world to know there's a car worth $2 million. Baruch Hashem. billions of mitzvot you can make. Instead, you buy a car to stay in the lobby that everyone clap for you. Wow. What a car you have. This is why I took you out of Egypt. Why did I take you out of Egypt? To serve? To be a football player? To be a chef? What? What's the reason? I answered you why. To be your God. And to test you. And to give you a set of laws. And in the end, I will reward you big time, or God forbid, I have to punish you. Because that's justice. It won't be in my hand anymore. I won't be able to waive the punishment. Why? There is no justice to the righteous people who pass the test. If everyone comes to the bar test, and one passed it, and all the other one went to the beach and did nothing, and they fell. So the teacher say, okay, I let you also get accepted. So what's the guy who learned say? You're a crook. You're not a fair teacher, you're a crook. You say, you learn, you pass, you get accepted. You fail, you don't get accepted. Now after I did all this work, you basically lied to me. Hashem cannot do it even if he wants. It's not an option. Many people think, one day I'll come to Hashem, I'll be okay with him. He's merciful, he's a father. I'm sure he will understand why I wasn't keeping Shabbat. I'm sure he understands why I wasn't eating exactly kosher and doing all kinds of other things. I'm sure he'll understand. Don't be so sure. Read the Torah a few times, you see that you're completely off. You're wrong. Based on what the Torah says, I did not write the Torah. I always say, if I would write the Torah, maybe I'll make it a lot easier. But I have no say. Nobody asked my opinion, not when it was written, and not today. Nobody has permission to modify it. Nobody has permission to hide things from it. Nobody has permission to stand in front of a person and knows what he's doing to himself and ignore it. It's also a violation of the rule. See a person destroying his soul and you say nothing? It's also a violation. You don't know how to talk, fine. You have a limitation. You're not exactly an expert on convincing people how to be religious. Hand them a CD. Give them a card of a good website that will encourage them. Invite them to a lecture. Invite them for Shabbat. Sometimes people come to a Shabbos table, that's enough for them to become religious. They see the harmony in a house, they say, you know what, a house like this I want. Sometimes they become religious from the kids of the host. It happened to me a few times in the past. That people told me after years, do you think that all the convincing you did with me, that's what really made me religious? No. When I came to Monsi and I saw the community and I saw the children and I saw the atmosphere, that really talked to me the most. Some people, it's the proofs. Some people, it's the fear. Depend on a person. Some people only fear works with them. What can we do? Better than nothing? Better than they will die wicked? No. Okay, if the fear will save you, fine. Some people go to the surgery because it's the right thing to do. Some people go to the surgery because they're afraid to die. Not because it's the right thing to do. They just don't want to die right now. Or the pain is too much. They have to do something about it. They have no choice. Not because it's the right thing to do. What's the proof? That many times when the doctor tells you, you can live like this 5 more years before it gets serious, right away think, okay, talk to me in 4 years. There's already a problem in the body that can be fixed right now. Talk to me in 4 years. It's not urgent right now. Same thing with cars. Here, I went to the dealer to do oil change. The guy said, you know, there's a recall on your car. Some cars have a leak. It can touch the computer. Can we do the recall now? I said, recall now, another 2 hours to sit here, waste my time here. So next week I'll come. What's probably happened after that? You never do it. It's free, it's free. It's a waste of time. So what's the point? The point is that a person think, I'll do only what's urgent right now. Maybe it will happen, maybe not, okay. But when it comes to life of eternity, what could be more urgent than that? So what does a person say? Right now I'm still alive. I'm still young, I'm still okay, I make good money. Talk to me later, when things will be problems, this maybe I'll consider to be religious. That's wrong. To become tzaddik, when everything works beautiful, it's a much higher level than when everything collapses, and then you search for the rabbis. No, It's better. Why, Moshe, who died? Why you became religious? Somebody died? Something happened? You sick? What happened? Everything is perfect. You sure? Business is good? Booming. Marriage is good? Great. Health is good? Yes. The children also? Yes. No problem, no FBI, no IRS, no crime, no mafia looking for you. Nothing, everything is perfect. You sure? Why so surprised? Why people surprised when, what happened? Tell me what happened. I'll pray for you. Why? Because they already think in their mind, only crazy people become religious or people that have a tragedy. Someone, everything is booming and normal. Why should they do such foolish thing? Why? But it's the opposite. The fool is not the one who became religious and close to his creator and followed the instruction to earn life of eternity. The fool is someone who ignores it and hope one day will be fine. It won't be fine. It will only get worse. The truth hurts. Someone has to say it. And I say to you just as much as I say to myself, we all have lots to improve. Let's improve. Let's begin to wake up. We'll see you, Bezrat. Next Monday, I'm not here. I'm going to be, Bezrat Hashem, in London. And the following Monday, we schedule to be here, back here. And Bezrat Hashem, in 2 weeks, I'll see you. Baruch Adonai L'olam. Amen v'amen.